Good morning. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Nobel Week Dialogue. My name is Adam Smith, and it's my honor to be your guide to the day's events. I'd like to thank you all for getting up so very early on a cold Sunday morning to be here, and to apologize for the queue that you had to stand in to get in. But it's really wonderful to see such a very full auditorium. I think we can promise a day full of excitement that will stimulate your thinking and imagination. To open the day's events, I would like to call upon the Executive Director of the Nobel Foundation, Lars Heckenstein, to give an opening address. Lars, welcome.
Your Excellencies, dear laureates, ladies and gentlemen, friends, a warm welcome to the Nobel Week Dialogue, the first of its kind. I have to say, first of all, that it's quite impressive to stand here and look to discuss scientific issues with us. I think that's really amazing. I think we should have an applause for that. During the Nobel Week in Stockholm, we are paying tribute to those who have won the Nobel Prize during their respective years. We are doing that by listening to their lectures, by handing over prizes at a formal ceremony, and by holding a magnificent banquet. The focus of the Nobel Week is naturally on the contribution and advancements that are being rewarded. This is as it should be. But Alfred Nobel had high ambitions for his prize. To him, it was not just a matter of naming the winners of a competition, but of achieving results long term. He wanted the prizes that bear his name to contribute to the greatest benefit of mankind. If we bear this in mind, there are good reasons to broaden our perspective during the Nobel Week and also highlight current issues that are related to the areas that Alfred Nobel singled out: science, literature, and peace. We have previously chosen to spread information about the Nobel Prize and to stimulate efforts and initiatives in the spirit of the Nobel Prize by building museums in Stockholm and in Oslo, as well as through a website and various publications and conferences. We are now also doing this by building a Nobel Prize Center here in Stockholm, which will serve as a meeting place in the spirit of Alfred Nobel. Today, we are doing this by organizing the first Nobel Week Dialogue, a forum for discussing vital current issues of a scientific nature during the Nobel Week. This explains the connection between the Nobel Week Dialogue and Nobel and the Nobel Week. But where does the idea of a dialogue come from? Well, we do not only wish to turn to the research community and the various experts in the field. We also want to reach out to the general public and highlight the exciting things that are happening in order to inspire and influence. And we want to pursue a dialogue with other segments of society, with those involved in the humanities, with decision makers, etc. When we do this, engaging in a dialogue, we feel confident that Alfred Nobel is on our side. This is not primarily because he was particularly interested in popular education. Popularization was actually rather foreign to Nobel, who must certainly be perceived as fairly elitist. No, there is another connection. Nobel cared very much about social progress. He wrote about it, he discussed it, and he worried about it. He was acutely aware that his activities not only had an impact on science, technology, and business, but also on social change, on war and peace, on life and death. This is what he wanted to influence with his prize. This year, we have chosen genetics as our theme. There is a particular reason behind this. In 2012, 20 years have passed since the discovery of the structure of DNA, since it was rewarded by a Nobel Prize, with a Nobel Prize. We have the pleasure of welcoming one of those who received that prize, Professor Watson, to today's events. But the most important reason for choosing genetics is another one. It's a subject which is vital to humanity and where major rapid advancements in the field are now being done. At today's Nobel Week dialogue, we will have a chance to update ourselves on what is happening in genetics. We will meet Nobel laureates and those whose contributions have been crucial in the field, as well as many of the best researchers active today. And we will see them engage in a dialogue with leading names in other areas of society. We do not know what the theme for next year's Nobel Week dialogue will be. Please let us hear your ideas during the day. But we have decided to arrange a Nobel Week dialogue 1 year from now, and we have also decided that it will take place in Gothenburg. I look forward today to an exciting day together with all of you. Once again, most welcome to the first Nobel Week dialogue. Thank you.
Thank you, Lars. Now, as you will see from your programs, the day is basically divided into two parts. The morning will be devoted to lectures and an interview with Jim Watson, and the afternoon to discussion panels in which we invite you, the audience, to take part, both you, the live audience, and you, the online audience. To start the lectures, we are delighted to have Eric Lander with us. Eric Lander is president and director of the Broad Institute of MIT and Harvard, and will be known to many of you as one of the principal investigators, principal leaders in the International Human Genome Project. His talk is entitled Five Turns of the Double Helix, and it's my pleasure to welcome Eric Lander.
Thank you so much. Well, thank you very much, Adam. When I got asked if I would come participate in the first Nobel Week dialogue, I was very excited at this new idea that science should be engaging with society in discussions about the impact that science is going to have in the coming decades. Now, I was also somewhat daunted when I heard what the assignment was. The goal, as I understand it, is first to help convey the unexpected power of scientific discovery. When Alfred Nobel designated his prize to those who have conferred the greatest benefit to mankind, it soon became apparent that it wasn't obvious to the general public why these arcane scientific discoveries that were awarded each year really truly conferred the greatest benefit to mankind. It often takes a long time to see why it confers such a great benefit. So one of the goals of this Nobel Week dialogue is to really help illustrate the power when a scientific idea plays out over the course of time. Now, in this case, you could not have chosen a better prize to celebrate than the 50th anniversary of the prize for the structure of DNA. And so my first job is to try to set that discovery in context. I'm going to set it in the context of the 20th century, what led up to it, and what has happened in the 50 years since the awarding of that prize, and perhaps what will happen in the years ahead. In addition, my second job is to lay a foundation for the discussion this afternoon about the impact of this genetic and genomic revolution on society. My third assignment is to do this all in 45 minutes, actually 43.12 remaining. And my fourth is to do this knowing full well that I will be followed by Jim Watson immediately afterwards. So I ask your sympathy and support in trying to fulfill these four missions in a very short time. All right. I've entitled this talk, Five Turns of the Double Helix, the Impact of Scientific Discovery. And I have divided up the history and future that I want to talk about into five parts. Now, to set the whole thing in context, though, I should say the 20th century, when people look back from many centuries from now, will clearly be known as the information century. Information was so central to the 20th century. Now, it's obvious in the case of computers. At mid-century, we went from this entire room that was a physical incarnation of a theoretical idea of computing machines that were thought of early in the 20th century, physically manifested in this just huge, incredibly complex, and not very powerful computer, you know, orders of magnitude less powerful than my smartphone. But over the course of 50 years or so, it transforms from that ENIAC machine there to my Mac Air, from which I'm projecting this presentation. But it wasn't just physical computers. It was also the information century in terms of life, because it turned out quite unexpectedly to those at the beginning of the 20th century that life was fundamentally about information, that information was encoded in organisms. And it went from mid-century, roughly the same time, this picture of Watson and Crick standing by their model of the double helix, pregnant with all sorts of possibilities, to a world we live in today, with an extraordinary amount of genetic information being used in so many different ways in medicine and far, far beyond. So the five turns of the double helix are how I'm going to try to describe this history. And those five turns are these. The first part, the first act of the play, I've called The Secret of Life. And it runs from about the beginning of the 20th century to 1953, with the discovery of the double helical structure of DNA. The second turn, the genetic code. The fourth turn, recombinant DNA. The third turn, recombinant DNA. The fourth turn, genomics. And then the future. So that's our plan. Let me start with that first turn, the secret of life. In the 1800s, life was incomprehensible. It did things that people had no idea that could possibly be done with the laws of physics and chemistry. It reproduced itself, faithfully transmitting information from one generation to the next in ways we could not conceive of. It carried out chemical transformations, reactions, fermentation in ways we couldn't possibly imagine how that could go on in a living organism, so much so that the philosophers had a doctrine they called vitalism, basically the notion that the laws of physics and chemistry were inadequate to explain living systems, and that there must be some other distinct kinds of principles that govern living systems. Well, the earliest part of the 20th century was the banishing of vitalism. In fact, there were two complementary ways in which this happened. One way of understanding life was genetics. Now, of course, this goes back to Mendel in 1865, but Mendel's work was largely forgotten for the next 35 years and only really was rediscovered, so to speak, around 1900. And so I assign it here to the 20th century. The idea that organisms contained information in a way that you could really follow. You couldn't see the information, but by the properties of mutants, organisms that lacked something, and their transmission patterns in families, you could infer the existence of particles of heredity, and they followed actual laws. The other half that was going on in parallel was the recognition that this chemical transformation, these chemical transformations that life could carry out, were actually understandable. Buchner, who received the Nobel Prize for this, ground up yeast and found that extracts of yeast could still carry on fermentation without any living cells there, quite remarkably. And eventually, people who also went on to win a Nobel Prize purified what it was in that extract that could carry on those reactions, and they turned out to be proteins, remarkable class of molecules that could carry out all sorts of chemical transformations. And so we had, for the first half of the 20th century, two powerful and completely distinct points of view. They were, in fact, perfectly complementary. Geneticists studied organisms missing one component, one defective component that they called the gene, although they didn't know what it was. Biochemists studied one component isolated away, purified away from the rest of the organism. Organism minus a component, component minus the organism. And the two sides had almost nothing to say to each other. Until around the 1940s. And in the 1940s, a conversation begins between these two different stories. Genetics gets used to study biochemistry, and mutants are discovered that are unable to carry out certain kinds of biochemistry. So genes, whatever they are, must somehow specify biochemistry. And then the power of biochemical purification was applied to heredity, and cells were ground up, and what was purified from them was heredity. Work beginning in the 1920s, but really reaching fruition in the 1940s and the early 1950s. And those two complementary pieces, understanding that genes controlled biochemistry and the tools of biochemistry could be used to purify genes, led, the most important point, to the recognition that that molecule of heredity was DNA. Now, it's not obvious what you do with that, but it was to some young people in the early 1950s. And what they realized was to make any sense out of that observation that this molecule, DNA, contained the secret of heredity, they would need to understand its structure. To understand function, they needed to know structure. And so some smart young people then went out to find the structure of DNA. And this is one of the great scientific stories ever told, and our next speaker has indeed written the great story of that. So I'm not going to attempt to tell that whole story with Jim coming on stage next, but I will note that X-ray crystallography, this famous photograph 51 taken by Rosalind Franklin, and theoretical interpretations, powerful theoretical interpretations by Jim Watson and Francis Crick, building models, comparing models to crystallographic data, led them to a model, led them to several models, the last of which turned out to be right. And it led them to a model that caused, as Jim Watson has written, Francis Crick to go into the Eagle Pub one day at lunch and declare to those who would listen, "We've discovered the secret of life." And they wrote up the secret of life, which appeared in this paper, this one-page beautiful paper in Nature, appearing in April 25, 1953, one of the most sublime papers. And what was so remarkable and why Francis Crick said we had discovered the secret of life was because the question of life was, how can you possibly store information, faithfully replicate information, and occasionally make mistakes in that information? And the answer was all there in the sequence of DNA. It was two anti-parallel strands with matching bases, complementary bases, each sufficient as a template for the other, each containing all the information necessary to make a copy of the double helix. And so reproduction was the splitting of these two strands and the filling in. And mutation was occasionally getting it wrong. And given this need to write this paper up very rapidly in 1953, there wasn't time to elaborate on this, and so it contains at the end the coyest sentence in all of molecular biology. It has not escaped our notice that the specific pairing we have postulated immediately suggests a possible copying mechanism for the genetic material. All right, so there it was, the secret of life, as Crick told the patrons of the Eagle Pub. But there was still a problem. How in the world did this DNA actually get read out into these proteins, these powerful proteins that carried out all the work of the cell? And that brings us to turn two of the double helix, the genetic code, the instructions for proteins. Well, we had these two pieces, genes, proteins. Somehow, genes contain the information for proteins. Obviously, it was in the sequence of the DNA letters. You must remember back in 1950, people were not used to writing things down in binary codes and things like that. And so people weren't used to the way we are with computers, the idea that you could specify information in an arbitrary string of letters. But it was clear somehow the string of letters contained the information, but it would need a physical manifestation. And what was worked out, and again, a Nobel Prize is awarded for this too, was the DNA indeed replicated by this mechanism of copying itself, using each strand as a template for the next. It was then read out into an intermediate, messenger RNA, and these messenger RNAs that contained a stretch of sequence from the DNA were then translated into the very different language of the amino acid building blocks of proteins. Now, how did the letters in the RNA correspond to the amino acids? There would need to be a lookup table somehow. In one of the most beautiful papers, to my mind, of genetics, Francis Crick and three co-authors managed to deduce that it must be a three-letter code. They did it without knowing the three-letter code by using powerful tools of genetics. They inferred the triplet nature of the genetic code, that three letters of sequence would specify individual amino acids. But we wanted to know what were the specific amino acids, and the biochemists now came to complement the geneticists by building synthetic RNAs and handing them over to extracts of the cell and seeing how they would be translated. And you translated into fee, and they were off. And soon enough was filled in the 64 possible codons of the genetic code, and that was it. We knew the genetic code. More Nobel Prize this year. But of course, we only knew the genetic code theoretically. You couldn't actually read a bit of the genetic code. You could make a synthetic RNA and translate it, but it didn't tell you what real genes did. And indeed, in the late 1960s, following the genetic code, a number of people in molecular biology said, okay, we're done. We've worked out the secret of life. Let's go on and figure out the secret of the brain. And some people left the field to go do that. But, as always is the case, a young generation came along and said, not so fast. We've got to actually know this, not just in theory, but in practice. How exactly can we read out this information? And with a gap of 4 or 5 years from the genetic code, the period, the turn of the double helix that I'll call recombinant DNA, reading a gene, emerged. So as I say, this triangle had been filled in. Biological function connected to gene from genetics, connected to proteins through biochemistry, and now genes connected to proteins through molecular biology, but entirely abstract. How could you possibly purify the gene for anything? Biochemists, they purified things by grinding up the cell and separating proteins based on their very different properties in the test tubes. Some of them were bigger and smaller and more charged and less charged. But genes, they all were the same biochemically. They were all stretches of DNA. You couldn't run a biochemical separation, a biochemical purification, to purify the gene for hemoglobin, the gene that encodes collagen, the gene that encodes keratin, because they all had the same biochemical properties. And so what it took was an entirely new kind of purification, one never seen before, and one that could only work for a self-replicating molecule. And that was this: to take all the DNA in a cell, shred it up into pieces, and attach it to other pieces of DNA, we call them vectors, that are able to propagate themselves, replicate themselves. And so you can make circles of DNA with a vector that is able to copy itself and attach to it a random piece of DNA. And now I have before me zillions of molecules. I can't see them, but they're all in the test tube, all distinct, having different pieces of the human DNA. And they can be transferred in mass into bacterial cells or other cells, and plate it out on a plate to grow. And then you have before you on your Petri plate a library, each of these bacteria replicating a different, at that point still unknown which one is which, but a different piece of the human DNA. So each piece of DNA has been purified down to a single molecule, that's easy by dilution, and then copied back up to make many copies of it within a bacterium. So that was incredibly powerful, that purification of genes by cloning and making libraries. But then you had to read the DNA. Well, how could you possibly read the sequence of DNA? Well, of course, if you want to do something hard, you go ask a master. And the master you ask is the cell itself. The cell is in the business of reading DNA. The enzymes that it uses to replicate DNA were co-opted, were borrowed by scientists to then read DNA ourselves. And so methods for DNA sequencing were developed. And here again, Nobel Prizes all over this slide for recombinant DNA and sequencing. And it became possible to read out sequences painfully slowly. It's about when I came along into molecular biology, and I remember the pain of reading 200 letters of DNA over the course of a week. But you could do it, and you could get sequence, and you could begin to see the separate and individual genes. And not just that, you could take the genes when you found them and attach them to vectors that could express the RNA and make the proteins. And thus was born an entire industry, the biotechnology industry, of using these genes to produce proteins of our choosing, such as an insulin to give to a patient with diabetes. Now, all that was very good. But there was still a big problem. What was the problem? The problem was you could separate the individual genes, sure. But how could you find which was which? Well, sometimes you were so clever that you knew which protein you were looking for, like insulin. And if you already had done the biochemistry and knew that insulin was crucial to diabetes, there were tricks you could use to find the piece of DNA that encoded insulin. And if you knew some bit of cell biology, you could use a trick of cell biology to clone the piece of DNA that you were looking for based on its function. So you could express it and find the piece of DNA that had that function. You could find a piece of DNA that expressed the protein you knew. But if you wanted to do medicine, you needed to know the basis of the disease. You needed to either know in advance that the disease you were studying was about insulin, or it was about a particular function that was missing in a particular way. But the problem, the deep dark secret here, is that for 95% of all diseases, we had no clue what the basis was. And we needed a systematic way to discover the genes responsible for diseases, a way that didn't require a prior hypothesis, an unbiased, a systematic approach to be able to do that. For example, there are simple one-gene rare Mendelian diseases, Huntington disease, cystic fibrosis, dystrophic dysplasia, and 5,000 other rare genetic diseases where there was no obvious way to know what was responsible for cystic fibrosis. People tried for decades guessing what was the biochemical basis. Or dystrophic dysplasia, a disease that's at higher frequency in Finland. It produces these bone defects. How would you know what to look for? So how could you use these tools of molecular biology? And then, of course, from rare single-gene diseases, one has much more common diseases, Alzheimer's disease, schizophrenia, inflammatory bowel disease, which were likely to involve many, many different genes. And even if you knew one or two of them, how could you begin to collect all the genes that would play crucial roles without having prior guesses? Of course, it's going to somehow take genetics to do that. And then, of course, cancer. Important discoveries revealed that cancer is a disease of the genome with genetic defects in the genome. Well, how are you going to find the genes that are responsible here? Not the inherited changes, but now the acquired mutations during your life that drive a cancer. How do you know where to look without some lucky guess or some very specific assay? So for all of these problems, biologists got to the early 1980s with these tools of recombinant DNA, but without a general systematic way, without principles to apply them to medicine. Now just think about how big that problem is. The human genome was 3 billion bases long. 3 billion bases. The coding sequence of a gene, the mRNA, might be 3,000 bases, actually a little less usually. And the mutation responsible for a disease gene, for a disease, might be one letter. In English, I don't know if this works in Swedish, we speak about finding a needle in a haystack. In fact, a friend of mine once calculated that that is too simple a problem for what this is, that needles, in fact, constitute much more than 1/3 billionth of a haystack. And so, in fact, it's harder than finding a needle in a haystack to be able to know where to go look. And so what we needed were principles for the systematic discovery of disease genes. And in the 1980s, a variety of principles were discovered for doing this. First, for these rare, inherited, monogenic disorders, these simple Mendelian traits, brilliant observation. David Botstein recognized that familial mapping, tracing inheritance in families, could let you find disease genes without any prior guess as to what they were about. For common inherited polygenic traits, well, you couldn't use families. A single family couldn't have enough information, but could you interpret populations as if they were a family and use population-based mapping? And then for cancer, direct comparisons of tumor and normal DNAs to begin to accumulate information. So let me briefly touch on these systematic principles for the discovery of disease genes, because they lay the foundation for this afternoon's discussion. The idea is actually very elegant, and indeed it goes back to fruit fly genetics of the early part of the 20th century in a way, which is that if two things live nearby on the chromosome, they will be transmitted together. And if I happen to have a mutation indicated by that red bar there and a little minus symbol that is transmitted to individuals in a family, well, any genetic mutation nearby will show the same pattern of inheritance. Now, of course, where are you going to get a good mutation to study? Well, the insight was that you could use DNA spelling differences to study it. And by collecting DNA spelling differences and tracing their pattern of inheritance and finding when you found one that matched the pattern of inheritance of your disease, you knew that your disease gene must live nearby. And then you could begin to isolate it. You could find out where it was before you knew what it was. Now, as I say, this doesn't work for complex diseases with multiple factors that don't automatically cause the full disease. And then the idea of extending family mapping to populations arose. That in fact, with very much denser sets of genetic markers up and down the chromosomes, you could follow segments of a chromosome, not just in a family, but in a population, and recognize when it was the same segment carried by many different people. In fact, just next door to Sweden, in Finland, was really where this idea first arose, because Finland is a genetic isolate, and it was most obvious there that individuals in Finland would still be carrying in their chromosomes records of ancestral chromosomes that came into Finland 2,000 years ago, and you could calculate how dense a genetic map you might need to trace that. So you could begin to trace those segments, and then by what's called linkage disequilibrium, find which genes were associated with which traits. Then for cancer, to find mutations, well, here, the idea really does require deep analysis of the whole human genome, because there you're looking not for ancestral segments in a family or ancestral segments in a population, but newly arising mutations in your own body. And that really would require getting a lot of sequence information. But in theory, if you looked at many tumors, many skin tumors from people with skin tumors, and could somehow compare their DNA from their tumor to their normal DNA, you could begin to collect the mutations and say, wow, in skin tumors, this particular gene sustains mutations very, very often. That's significant. It must mean something. And you can begin to map the genes for that. Well, Those were all nice theoretical ideas, and I think they were all clear by the late 1980s. But they were all completely impossible to carry out in practice because we didn't have a human genome sequence. We didn't have the information of the human genome. And so structure again became important. From principle, it was necessary for scientists to move to practice. How were we going to get the sequence of that genome? Now, it's very different to get the entire sequence of the human genome than to get the structure of a turn of the double helix. To put this structural problem in context, I show you the picture on the left, which is DNA exploded out from a bacteria. That's what you're trying to get, is the exact sequence of letters across that big plate of spaghetti. Of course, that's just the bacteria. The human spaghetti is 1,000 times larger than that, and you need to work out the molecular structure for that. And to put it in context, an amino acid, a building block of a protein, that's 200 molecular weight. A turn of the double helix, about 6,000-7,000 molecular weight. A protein, 20,000. The ribosome, 2 million molecular weight. The human genome is 2 trillion in molecular weight. How to do it? Well, the tools of crystallography, for example, that served in structures so well, clearly were not going to work. You couldn't crystallize the human genome and solve it that way. And instead, new principles were developed, principles of hierarchical mapping, starting with a scaffold of genetic markers whose inheritance you could trace, then getting physical markers, the actual pieces of DNA that you could tie to that genetic map and overlap with each other, and then having hierarchically done that, read out the individual sequences. And a very important innovation was the principle that was espoused at that time in the mid-1980s that all of that information should be made freely, completely available to everybody because it was going to be needed by every scientist. So anyway, the scientific community moved from principles to practice. A rough genetic map, a laughably simple genetic map of 403 genetic markers of the human was developed in 1987, but at least it was a genetic map. And then onward from there, is the computer stopped? Oh, sadness. Oh, this is very sad. Computer. Well, I'm going to reboot it. It looks hung. No, it's not okay, but that's all right. They're here. They're not going anywhere. We're going to shut it down, and we're going to restart. Keep the suspense, okay? We're going to restart and think happy thoughts about the computer here. So from a rudimentary genetic map that just had 403 markers scattered across the human genome, it was then a worldwide effort to try to organize a whole sequence of the human genome. And this was a project that involved people from many different countries. 6 different countries participated in this: the United States and the United Kingdom, and France, and Germany, and Japan, and China. Are we working? Oops. Yeah? I'm going to take that out. Oh, here we go. Well, that's a good sign. Good. Excellent. Go for it. Success? Let's see. Yep. Yeah. Yes, all right. It's just thinking. Okay. My computer is restarted because of a problem. I knew that, actually. Okay. Yes. We're in business. Excellent. Good. The television guys will just edit that out. It'll have never happened. So what happened then was, went from these extraordinarily rudimentary maps to an entire world working together. 6 different countries working together, many different investigators all sharing their data, taking a biology that had been done individually at the bench and making it, inventing whole new methods to make it larger scale. And remarkably, by 2001, a rough draft sequence of the human genome was available. A rough draft sequence, still very imperfect, but still had only about 90% of the sequence of the human genome, but available. And then by 2003, a finished sequence of the human genome was available. Now, I note the Human Genome Project arranged specifically to complete its work on April 25th, 2003, as an homage to the Watson-Crick paper that was published exactly 50 years before to the day. That's how influential that Nobel Prize to the double helix was, that the entire Human Genome Project aimed to complete on precisely the half-century mark of that paper. Okay, so now we had a sequence of the human genome. The problem was, it wasn't so easy to read this thing. What did it all say, these 3 billion bases? And so most of the past decade has been spent decoding the human genome. It turned out that this initial effort to build genetic maps and physical maps and sequence maps was just a prelude to much more map building. Layering on top information, mapping became a principle of biology. Layering on top information about the genes, using RNA sequences to figure out where the genes are. Layering on top information about genetic variation in the human population, all the variants we could find in the population and how they're correlated with each other. Layering on top the sequence of other species, evolutionary comparison, first of mouse within a year, and then dog and rat, and 24 different mammals, and now 50 different vertebrates, and seeing the hand of evolution at work in which letters were conserved and which letters were allowed to freely drift. And then epigenomic maps, maps of the marks that sit on top of the genome, the proteins that are bound in the genome in different places, and chemical modifications to those proteins, all of which could be interrogated, sequenced, and referenced back to that fundamental map of the genome. Now, all this got a lot easier during this past decade because the technology for sequencing improved dramatically. During the Human Genome Project, we were also proud of sequencing 1 billion bases. Well, what's happened since then? Oh, no, there we go. Where did it go? Oh, come, goodness. It's still cooking here. Oh, goodness, goodness. Oh, did that do something? Back. PowerPoint encountered an error and needs to quit. That's very unfortunate. How does it quit from here? Okay, we press OK. PowerPoint's going to quit. But the computer hasn't crashed. That's always good. And PowerPoint is going to start up again. Come. Keep the suspense. Okay. Yes, okay. So the power of sequencing has increased 1 million-fold over the course of this period. Stunningly, when it took $3 billion to sequence the human genome. It now costs $3,000, $4,000, or $5,000 to sequence a human genome all over the course of a decade. It is mind-boggling. I know nothing in experience, in history, that has ever decreased by a factor of 1,000,000-fold in the course of a bit more than a decade. Even computers go much more slowly than that. So suddenly it's possible, from needing an entire world to sequence a human genome, to being able to sequence many, many, many thousands of human genomes. So what have we learned in the past couple of years from all this information? Well, as we've begun to finally read that sequence of the genome, we've learned that, first, there are a lot fewer protein-coding genes in the human genome than we ever expected. The advertisement for the human genome was it was going to have 100,000 genes. Turned out only to have about 20-odd thousand genes, much less than we ever expected. But if it had many fewer of these conventional protein-coding genes, DNA goes to RNA goes to protein, it had many other strange things we never expected. It had many thousands of genes where DNA went to RNA and never went to protein. And the RNA itself functioned as a functional molecule. Many thousands of these non-coding RNAs, shorts and longs. And it contained in the genome most of what evolution had preserved in the genome was not genes at all, but regulatory sequences. And now we know millions, up to 3 million regulatory sequences across the genome. And it turns out to be harder to regulate a gene properly than to make the protein. Gene regulation is incredibly rich. And we've learned many other interesting surprises, that there are transposable elements that hop around the genome. Well, we knew that, of course, before, but what we've learned is that they help spread evolutionary innovation, and that these things that we viewed as parasites, as junk, have instead become, in our minds, symbionts shaping our genome. So many of those things emerged. But what happened to this medicine idea? The idea that we wanted to apply principles to the human genome for disease. How have those principles fared now that we have the tools? And this, of course, sets up our afternoon discussion. For monogenic diseases, those rare individual monogenic diseases, the number of disease genes we knew back in 1987, about when those principles were well established, was about 20. By the time the human genome sequence was completed, however, the availability of that information got it up to about 1,700. By today, 3,500 of those monogenic diseases have been identified. There's about another 2,000 still to go in the catalog, but we've already got the majority of the catalog, and I think we feel confident that these principles will go on now to teach us the vast majority of the information about the basis of monogenic diseases. What about the more common polygenic diseases that affect us? Well, back in 1987, 25 years ago, we sort of knew about one gene that was important to these common diseases. It was the HLA locus. Even right after the human genome, it had only gone up to about 20. But in the past decade or so, it has now skyrocketed with the tools that we'll talk about today to more than 2,000 such loci, genes in the genome connected with common diseases using a variety of different methodologies. I'll just cite examples here. The most common form of adult blindness, macular degeneration. We had no idea what caused it. We now know it's a disease of the alternative complement pathway. Inflammatory bowel disease. We had no idea what caused it. But as of today, 160 genes have been definitively causally implicated in it and point to pathways. Pathways for a certain receptor called interleukin-23, pathways called autophagy, where many, many, many genes in this pathway are all implicated, and you know that this pathway is important, very much like the kind of thing Drosophila geneticists could do in development, for which indeed Jannie Nussland-Volhard is here today. Lipids and myocardial infarction. Mendelian genetics gave us about 24 genes that played such a role. Now another 80 have been found that play roles, some of which, things like PCSK9, have given rise to powerful therapeutics, because there's a common genetic variant in PCSK9, about 2% in the African-American population, that pointed to its role in lipids. Other genes are being identified in that way. At the same time, these genes are telling us about some mistakes in our thinking. Pharmaceutical companies have spent billions of dollars trying to make drugs to increase your HDL, your good cholesterol. Well, it turns out that good cholesterol is correlated with protection from heart disease, but good cholesterol, that doesn't prove that increasing your good cholesterol will protect you from heart disease. The genetics clearly tells you that that theory is flawed, that individuals who inherit genetic variations that give them good cholesterol at higher levels are not protected from heart disease. But bad cholesterol, yes, indeed, inheriting those genes do indeed put you at risk. Schizophrenia, we knew nothing. Today, 62 genes associated with schizophrenia definitively, including four of them affecting the same calcium channel, beginning to teach us things, and onward and onward. And for cancer, we've grown from 10 or so to more than 600 definitively identified genes here. And not just the kinds of genes we knew before, but in the past decade, genes of all sorts of new types, chromatin regulators and protein synthesis, genes involved in protein synthesis and homeostasis and metabolic enzymes, giving rise to new drug targets. Now, let me say, the problem is we still don't know the full basis of disease. We are still on a steep part of this learning curve. And anyone who tells you we know everything about the basis of disease from this is not realistic. There is still another decade or more of work to fill out this information. But it's at least moving down. And as we see, every turn of the double helix pushes us further and further to that eventual goal of conferring benefit on mankind. So it brings me to the last turn of the double helix. The future. It is always a mistake to talk about the future. I learned that when I was asked to write an essay for a volume being published in the year 2000 about what was going to have happened by the year 2100. And I had the good sense to look back at the volume that had been written in 1900 to see what people said about what would be the case in the year 2000. And it was so embarrassing. So I'm going to try to be very cautious about making projections here. But I'll say some things that I think are really clear, at least about the next turn of the double helix. We must move from fragmentary and fragmented data to a global, complete knowledge resource. We have bits and pieces of information about disease yet. We don't have the complete picture. And we're going to be collecting it all over our medical system. And we have a choice ahead of us in the next several years. Are we going to share that information? Or is it going to be kept behind many separate walls and prevent us from learning about it? So we must, and I hope we will talk about how we can make sure that all this information being generated everywhere is brought together in a way respectful of patient privacy, of course, but brought together so we can learn from it. I've said we're learning about biological mechanism, but all too often people think that biological mechanism immediately translates into therapies. There is still a whole series of work to turn things into therapies. And we can't tell the public, but because we are now getting mechanisms for schizophrenia or mechanisms for a certain type of diabetes, they should expect cures next year. That isn't the way it works. It still will take a long time, and we must now see if we can bring that same degree of serious work to converting mechanisms to medicines. And finally, we've spent most of the past years reading the DNA code. We are going to increasingly see people writing DNA code. Increasingly, a field of synthetic biology will grow up. I don't just mean copying the DNA letters in an organism. I mean writing your own code, writing your own controls. I have a book here, A Complete Guide to Program in C++, a programming language that computer scientists like. We will see over the next decade or two young scientists develop D++, the programming language for DNA, as we can write general purpose code out of DNA. So, five turns of the double helix. We made it. My computer made it, almost. Five turns from the secret of life to the genetic code to recombinant DNA to genomics and medicine to the future. From a sublime insight to something that I think was unimaginable by anybody back in 1953 or 1962 when the Nobel Committee had the wisdom to award a prize to the double helix, that we would move from this sublime insight to the infinite library of life, reading all the information of life around us and being able to write our own volumes in it as well. That, I think, is the power of scientific discovery, to push us to the unimaginable and, in the words of the will, to do it to confer the greatest benefit on mankind. Thank you for the invitation to kick off this fantastic symposium. Thank you for organizing it, and I look forward to the day.
What a pleasure it is to work with somebody who truly understands their assignment. Thank you. I don't think we could have possibly had a better overview to set up the day. Now, as Lars mentioned, we're honored today by the presence of Jim Watson. And he's one of the very few Nobel laureates to return to Stockholm 50 years after the award of his Nobel Prize. And we are going now to have him on stage for an interview, which will be conducted by Matt Ridley, who is probably known to many of you as a journalist and author. His books have been 900,000 copies, I gather, of his books have been sold, and his books have been translated into over 30 languages. So may I welcome Matt and Jim on stage, please. And Matt, because we've started late, so you have, I think, 20 minutes from now, if that's okay.
Thank you very much indeed. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Now, as Erik Lander said, the significance of the double helix was that it suddenly and immediately made clear that there was a linear digital code at the heart of life. And for all the contributions of other people, and there were great contributions by other people, nonetheless, there was only one person who first saw that insight at 10 a.m. on the 28th of February, 1953, in Cambridge. And that was you, Jim. You've done it many times before, but can you recall that moment to us when you saw the base pairing, when you saw that A and T was the same shape as C and G?
Yeah, I generally get to or got to the lab around 9 in the morning. And I wanted to put together pairs of bases. And we've been delaying doing it because I told the machine shop to make some metal models, and they didn't come, and finally I just cut them out of cardboard. So the first base pairs were of cardboard. And I should have, immediately started with Chargaff's pairs. You think, well, A equals T and G and C, why don't you put them together? But I had met Chargaff about 9 months before and intensely disliked him. And I didn't want to use his data. So, in putting together pairs, I immediately discovered that we wanted something in which the center of the molecule was the same irrespective of sequence that we needed for the perfect molecule. And, found that putting together A and T gave absolutely identical shapes. And so immediately Francis would come in about 10, and he saw it and immediately saw the symmetry of the base pair, that you could flip-flop them, and so...
That confirmed his insight that the chains must run in opposite directions,
which strengthened your resolve. He had correctly interpreted Rosalind Franklin's space group, which was C2, I think, and it implied diadaxid and two chains running parallel to the fiber axis. And so a diadaxid, you would achieve that by having one chain run in one direction and one in the other. And So all that was apparent within, 15 minutes of his coming in the room.
So, but just, because eureka moments like this don't happen very often in science. The whole idea that there's a code and that the code can self-copy and that this actually is all you need, you don't need quantum physics or something to explain life. It's an information system. Yes. This was all apparent that morning, or did it take a few days to sink
in? No, it was all that morning because, I suddenly realized, there was a reason for Chagas ratios. And I had not felt it was safe not to use them because the analytical methods weren't good, and when the GC base pair was really very accurate, but the AT, the A's were always somewhat less than the T's were less than the A's. So I could say it really wasn't perfect base pairs. Then 2 weeks later, I went to Paris and met Jerry Wyatt, who had done very accurate base analysis of a virus of the spruce budworm. And they were absolutely perfect, A equals T, G, and C, much better than Chagas.
Right.
So, there was no doubt that all DNA was going to be base paired. There wasn't going to be, there was something which didn't show the ratios. But, we had... it was sort of too good to be true, and it was so simple. And we could have shut it 2 weeks before if I just cut the things out of cardboard. And but it was a beautiful spring, and I was quite happy without the DNA structure. I was playing tennis every day, and socially, we were having lots of fun. And Francis one day did tell me that, I should play less tennis. And I should really. And now you could say, well, why didn't Francis try and build the base? Francis just talked to me. He never touched any part of a DNA model until we had the base pairs. His attention went totally to the DNA. But you could say, before then, Francis's attention to DNA was at most 5% of his time, because he was doing his thesis on a very dull...
Yeah. And he once said that if Jim Watson had been killed by a tennis ball, I would not have discovered the structure of DNA. In other words, that you were vital to that process of bringing him into it. And you needed his crystallographic knowledge and your biological knowledge.
It wasn't my biological knowledge. I had only one objective in life, which was to get the DNA structure. Whereas Francis could do many things in a crystallographic world and could keep busy without thinking about DNA. Yeah. Whereas for me, it was an all or none thing. I had gone to Cambridge to get the DNA structure.
A few months later, he wanted to give a talk on the radio about this, and you objected. And one of the things you said in your objection is, there are those who still think we pirated data. How worried were you about the fact that you were relying entirely on other people's data for this work? And did you feel guilty about that?
No, but I knew, Morris Wilkins never complained. He had a person named Willie Seeds who worked with him, and Willie is the one who 2 years later saw me in Switzerland, and he was coming down from a mountain, and I was going up with a Swiss friend. And he saw me and he said, "How's Honest Jim?"
How's Honest Jim?
And so that became, it was too good not to use as a title for my book.
Let's move on. So
there was the fact, was it fair to think about other people's data?
Yeah.
And we clearly did. Now, The final justification was when Linus Pauling jumped in, that there were three people, and Sir Lawrence Bragg, who wanted to have this sort of gentleman's agreement, proteins for Cambridge, nucleic acids, kings. Once he saw that Pauling was there, wanting to get the DNA structure, and the fact that the King's people weren't building models at all. The worst thing that could have happened for Bragg would be for the Americans to get the structure. So,
there's a newly rediscovered letter from Maurice Wilkins to Francis Crick, just after the discovery, in which he says, "To think that Rosie had all the 3D data for 9 months. Christ."
Yeah.
See, Wilkins was the one who was most upset by the fact that they could have done it at King's, but you did it.
Yes. So I didn't feel guilty, but it was just from the viewpoint that since we'd won the big prize... we hadn't had Nobel yet, but, we'd had it, that... don't brag about it.
Okay.
So going on the, BBC was to me bragging. And, I had got to Cambridge and realized that, understatement was the way to generally success in Cambridge. Francis, of course, was just the opposite. He saw no point of understating something important.
So a few years later, you write a book about it, which becomes an enormous bestseller. So perhaps you've changed your mind about bragging about it, but it's in a way a very modest book, because you're sort of throwing open your own mistakes, and you don't come out of it as the hero. I mean, Crick comes out of it as the hero.
Yes, I know.
And for those of us who've struggled occasionally to write something approaching a bestseller, you just effortlessly produce one of the great books about science that's ever been written. Great non-fiction novel, as it's been described. Did you write it? What was the thinking behind writing The Double Helix?
Well, the girls, I would tell them the story, try and make myself interesting to them. So, I had... the story was... people liked the story, and then... Francis...
Within a year of writing the book, you'd got married.
No. Within a month of its publication, got married. And
so it worked.
Yeah, we're still married 45 years later, so it was an enormous success.
A round of applause for Liz Watson.
But I realized it was a very good story, and I had been a University of Chicago education. The University of Chicago education was, as an undergraduate, it was reading the great books. I went there with an intense interest in science, so I combined the two. But some people just read great books for their undergraduate education. And
you became an undergraduate at the age of 15.
Yes.
I mean, you were a prodigy. Very.
No. I had an ordinary, IQ equal to getting into Harvard. Not that high. Around 120. I mean, I'm just trying to tell you, perfectly acceptable. You're not dumb, but you're not, going to be a math professor. And it was good enough to survive under most circumstances. And I knew I had a great story. And my aim was to write a great book, and so I wanted to write something as good as The Great Gatsby. So that was, my aim was... And Gatsby appealed to me because, he wasn't what he seemed. There was something shady, okay? And, the title, Honest Jim, suggests something shady. Now, Francis, was the supreme intelligence, really... him about personal relations, because he said, you can't use the title honest Jim, you're saying it's the honest truth. No, I had to tell friends, no, it's because people questioned our honesty in thinking about the king's data.
Francis Crick and Maurice Wilkins both threatened to sue you for libel if you published, and Harvard University Press pulled out of the project. But you stuck to your guns. Just talk us through that.
Well, you know, after they had threatened libel suits and Harvard decided not to publish the book, I got a very good, really turned out America's finest libel lawyer. And he said there wasn't a word of libel in the book. And when Athenaeum published it, they had their own lawyer who read it and wanted things like, you know, I've seldom seen Francis in a modest mood, instead of I have never seen him, you know. And he said, don't make a single change. And I didn't. And, you know, in retrospect, you know, I had the best advice in the world, and it cost me only $400. You know, if you really, you know, $400 for, you know, that's about 10 minutes of time of a high-powered Wall Street lawyer now.
And even Crick soon came to realize that it was a brilliant book and that it was the making
then,
of his reputation.
Then, you know, after the book came out, he said, you know, I'm getting invited out to parties because of your book. So he, you know, he began to see that he was, I knew it from the start, the one person who would, you know, in a sense, really wish the book hadn't come out was Maurice Wilkins. But by that time, he had received the Nobel Prize, so it wasn't going to affect, you know, his recognition. And Francis and I were very relieved when he got the Nobel Prize. And because, you know, without him, we wouldn't have done the work. And, you know, that, you know, evening, after the polling thing, when I went to London and he took out the drawer and showed me the beat picture, you know, they had the structure a month afterwards.
Yeah, that photograph, B51, photograph 51 of the B form.
Yes.
Crick got a lot out of that, of what you said you'd seen in that photograph.
Yes.
You were based on having been shown it by Maurice Wilkins. Maurice Wilkins had been given it by Rosalind Franklin, but it had originally been taken by Raymond Gosling.
Yes,
and it's worth remembering his role in the story.
Yes. I mean, I did reward Gosling for taking it. He's a really clever man. He came up to me about 10 years ago with 7 original reprints of the double helix,
of the article in Nature,
and wanted me to autograph them. And of course I did, and you know, it was enough to send his children through college. So he's such a nice man.
He is.
And he doesn't get the credit. You know, Rosalind gets the credit for the picture, and Wilkins gets the credit for the A picture, but both were taken by Gosling, who then spent most of his career as a medical physicist. Mm-hmm.
You became the first leader of the Human Genome Project, which was quite an ambitious thing to take on. What were you trying to set out to achieve? And a few years later, why were you fired from that job?
Well, no, I wanted it started, and I wanted it under the control of the National Institutes of Health. And the Department of Energy had said they were doing it, but the people who were doing it were not impressive. And so my aim was to get it done by highly intelligent people, a project which sounded, in a sense, boring and dull, just, you know, because there were initially no clever ideas around how to do it elegantly. And so I think it was, you know, in 86 is when I met Eric Lander first. And, you know, my aim was just to get money to give to people like Eric, and originally we passed out money to 20 people, and then it got, you know, finally down really to three or four big labs.
Three or four big labs that did
yes,
the work.
And you know, yeah. It was going to go. At that time, Wally Gilbert wanted to do it all by himself.
Right.
And he wanted a private company to do it and to own it.
Well, this was the issue that you fell out with the health secretary over, which was the patenting and the ownership of the genome. And you wanted to establish the principle that it should be...
No, I thought it would be just a mess if...
if people were able to patent.
Yes, I thought, you know, patent the products, the protein products of genes, but just keep the genes, and certainly from a diagnostic viewpoint, hey. And we have the case now with the breast cancer genes under private ownership, with really obscene sums required for the tests, which could be done, you know, for several hundred dollars, costing several thousand. And so, and interestingly, our Supreme Court has agreed now to hear the case, to rehear it.
Right.
And so they're going to decide. And, you know, it'll be very interesting to finally, you see, the Europeans have never recognized the patent.
Right.
And so, well, the Brits may be just stupid enough to pay the Americans, but I don't know. Certainly the French aren't paying the Americans for it.
We've only got 1 minute left, and I wanted to just end with, if you were a young scientist today, what would you be setting out to try and do? Mental illness, cancer, RNA interference, epigenetics. What's sort of for you the most exciting?
Oh, cure cancer.
I mean, and how long would that take you?
If I was running the effort, 10 years. But you know, if it goes on as it is, 50. You know, because we have a whole world of people whose job just, you know, if they solve it in 10 years, they'd be out of a job. So they don't work 24 hours a day. The cancer research world is almost asleep, by my standards, you know, of intensity.
Well,
I think
that's a wonderful message on which to end. Thank you very much indeed, Jim Watson.
Thank you so much. I hate to stop the conversation, especially at that point, and moreover, the entire audience hates me for stopping it. But there we go. Thank you both very much indeed. And if people want to have a chance to listen to more of Jim Watson, we're actually screening an interview that you and Francis Crick did in 1993 at UT Southwestern over lunchtime, so people can go up and watch that on screens on the other side of the hall. Now we have a coffee break, and given that we're running a little bit late, I wonder if we can try and be a little bit tighter on time, so perhaps we could all try and be back here by exactly 11 o'clock. Coffee is served just outside the doors. Thank you.
has like a 300-page thing of attention, not one group of attention, or the eye of one.
Hanterar du det också? Han verkar vara van vid det.
Ja, lite var det så.
Ja.
Kan ju ta
det. Ja, bra.
Är ni fattning av de här serverade skyltarna?
Ja, yes.
Det ser för jäkligt ut på bild, så att vi lägger dem på stolarna.
Ja, bra, bra, jättebra.
Är det någon av er som har sett? Det var någon fotograf som lånade en ställpinne och ändrar ljuset.
Kanske var där nere på...
Thank you.
Hello again, everybody. Welcome back, and thank you for being so prompt in having coffee and getting back into the lecture hall. We have already witnessed incredible flights of imagination this morning, and it's been marvelous. Imagination seems to be something that I am lacking in, I notice, because when I look at this photograph, I notice that I seem to be wearing exactly the same clothes. Exactly as I was when I was photographed. For our second speaker this morning, I'm pleased to say we have Professor Helga Novotny. Helga Novotny is Professor Emeritus of the Social Study of Science at ETH Zurich and also President of the European Research Council. And the title of her talk is A Social Scientist in the Land of Genomic Promise. So she is going to give the society side of the coin, if you like, complementing Eric Lander's view of the science of genomics. So, Helga.
Thank you, Adam. Thank you. It's a great honor for me to stand here today, and a double pleasure. One part of the pleasure comes from my function as president of the European Research Council. We are funding bottom-up frontier research without any thematic priorities. And talking to politicians around Europe who want to see quick results, I would like every politician in Europe to have listened to Eric Lander's lecture before, to assure them whatever is funded at the frontier of science will bear benefit, but you cannot have it right away. The second pleasure comes from being invited here as a social scientist. I have been working for the largest part of my professional life in a field called social studies of science and technology. So my colleagues and I study the science system and scientists. And you may wonder, what does a social scientist do in the land of genomic promise? So this has been with us for a long time. This is a picture, as you can see, from 1546, and it encapsulates the wishes, the imagination, the aspirations of many of us. I want to first start with the promise. What is a promise? In the most general sense, you can say a promise is hope without hype, if you have reason to expect something. But you can also make it a bit more sharper, the definition, and then you come to the law. The law has known promises leading up to contracts for a very long time. And therefore, you can say a promise is a legally binding commitment that you will fulfill something that you have promised in the future, or you will not do something in the future. But I would like to use the term promise here in a more metaphorical sense, if you want. The promise which binds science and society together. Sometimes we speak about the contract, again, in a loose sense, there are expectations on the part of the public, expectations to fund science, and on the part of scientists, the aspiration that something is coming in return. The benefits that we also heard that Alfred Nobel was expecting from those who have been honored with the prize bearing his name. So how and when did this contract between science and society, the promise, the hope that we have in science, begin? Barely 400 years ago. Let's remember that science is an institutionalized activity, not people having scientific ideas. This has been part of humankind from the very beginning, that people were wondering, how does the universe function? How does the human body function? How does society function? These are old questions that have accompanied humankind from the beginning. But as an organized activity, it is relatively new. As you notice, in those days, there was not yet one woman. and what was behind it. Now, I would like to point out to one promise that is not often mentioned. When we think back what has these 400 years of science brought to society, we very often think of the benefits, we think of the improvements that have been made. But initially, there was another promise, which I think is very important. It started with the inquiry into the laws of nature. Mind you, the term law was taken from society, and the laws of nature were something that were able to put society and those following those laws would put you above and beyond the arbitrariness of the political and religious powers of the day. The laws of nature could not be bent by kings nor by religious authorities. And it was this promise that science leads us into something that means approximating a truth that is above the arbitrariness of political and religious powers, which was the most important promise at the very beginning. And this is why mathematics played such an important role. Galileo, who spoke about nature as a book which is written in mathematical language. But then, of course, there was the other promise of human betterment. I have called this picture Horizon 1620 in allusion to Horizon 2020. As you know, the European Union will soon begin its new framework program funding research at European level, and it's called Horizon 2020. But there was, in fact, a Horizon 1620. And this was the year in which Francis Bacon, one of many in Europe in those days, who was using this opening up, sailing through the Pillars of Hercules into the unknown. This is the author and the frontispiece of the book. And what Bacon and others promised was the effecting of all things possible. How could this come about? It was carried by the belief that the systematic inquiry of phenomena in the natural world was the way to succeed in bettering the human condition, using the experimental method and having very practical objectives. In fact, Bacon spoke about experiments of light, something that we would now call fundamental research, and experiments of fruit, but in fact, the two are linked. What is also important if we look back historically is modern science started in the 17th century, antecedents in the 16th century, and it was a European phenomenon all over Europe. You had small groups of people who called themselves natural philosophers who were engaged in this kind of systematic inquiry. It led to a shift in expectations in societies, and it was carried by very strong belief in progress, a word we hardly use today. But this belief in societal progress was very important to sustain the venture, even though, and this is what historians tell us again and again, it took a long time to see any materialization of the promises and the expectations that existed. Okay, with this adjustment, I continue. And in the 18th century, in fact, there was a lot of trial and error going on. The wish to know was far greater than what people actually knew. And it took something that we call the Industrial Revolution or the Industrial Enlightenment to bring together, to provide the kind of infrastructure in society to move on to something that we call science-based technologies. And the role of technology, this was already mentioned also by Eric Lander, how important it is to have also research technologies in place. The role of technology is one that has now led to technology being science-based, while in the larger part of human history, technology was something done by trial and error, but it was only when it came together with science that it was able to become the driver in scientific advance that we see today. Let me take a very quick look back. Promises, and I'm speaking now about general promises as I covered this very large period historically. Some have been fulfilled, many only partly, others unfulfilled, and we can go on debating this. But one of the most remarkable is the longevity. Human lifespan has been extended enormously. And what you see very nicely in this curve is the mortality rate, the probability to die in a specific year. And these are data, the red line above is the mortality rate, in this case these are French women, but the data are very similar in Europe, at least not in the developing world. In 1920, we were at the age of 60, women now are at the age of almost 80. What we also see in this historical period is an enormous reduction in working time. This curve shows you how much free time due to the benefits that were accumulated have been achieved. And if you ask what have we done with this free time, you can see the objects we are using, mobile phones, factor increase by 50 from the year 1950 onwards, television sets. We produce not so many more books and activities per year. We all seem to fly around the world, as you can see from the increase in passengers. And the question, of course, is this a material growth without limits? Let me now move to the land of genomic promise. This sense of a revolutionary breakthrough, of an epochal change, is nothing new in itself. Historians going back in time tell us that at every epoch in history, people had the feeling there were new discoveries, there were new possibilities that were opened that had not existed before. So this in itself is not the most spectacular genomic promise in itself, but rather what has changed around the world itself. And the genomic promise now is a global enterprise. It's global in nature. The market is global. Investment flows globally. And whatever is done in terms of data, decentralized networks, the kind of collaborations that internationally are possible, all this has to be thought of in global terms. It also means that the experience of the individual has changed, and it also means a major challenge to the relationship between science and democracy, because the options that have become open now are, for the first time in human history, I think, greater than they ever have been before. And what are we doing with this? Engineering life. Eric Lander spoke about synthetic biology already. I will not go much into it, but just to read you one of the visions that Bacon already had. This has been written by Bacon in 1620, when he says, we make one tree or plant turn into another. We make them different color, shape, activity, many ways. We do this not by chance, but we know beforehand what we do. So these are some of the main promises that exist, and the driver in society is the promise of human enhancement. Society means people, means individuals, means families, populations. And as Richard Powers, an American novelist, said, people want everything. That's their problem. Now, let me turn to the meeting of the life world today and the genomic promise. The life world is a term that goes back to philosopher Edmund Husserl, who in 1936 wrote about the gap that arose between scientific explanation in his days, this was physics above all, and the gap that separated what he thought was what scientists knew, the language they used, and the everyday world of experience. And he pointed out, being a phenomenological philosopher, he pointed out people's experience comes through their senses. This experience is validated by language, by talking to each other, by institutions, by trust. And today's life world meeting, the genomic promises, scientists have to realize that the life world constitutes an ambivalent mixture. On the one hand, there is we have the highest educational level ever in history, today's population. We have internet and Google and access to information, and people are learning how to use it. And this gives this sense of an enormous speeding up of scientific and technological progress. And what does it do with one's own life? But, and this distinguishes us from our predecessors in the 18th century, or 17th century for that matter, we no longer have this belief in a linear, steady material progress. People have come to realize the complexity, the messiness of today's world. And as Rosalind Williams has pointed out, also the term of crisis, something you open the newspaper, it hits you every day. The sense and the meaning of the word crisis has changed. It's no longer, as it originally meant, the turning point in an illness, and then you either become better or worse. But crisis apparently has become a condition here to stay. And we see the financial crisis, the economic crisis, environmental crisis, etc., etc. And this mixes, sometimes in a very ambivalent way, with what the American Museum of Natural History, in its exhibition in 2001, grandly announced, the genomic revolution is here. Are you ready? Now, meeting with the life world, the social life world, and these genomic promises entails, in my view, several key components. And one, I think, is that we may be entering a second renaissance, in the sense that it was the renaissance that put the individual at the center of the cultural world, the political world. It gave the individual the sense it's no longer fate, but you can shape your own fate. And the what genomics has to offer to the individual is the uniqueness of the individual in a very deep sense, while showing at the same time the relatedness of the individual to others, and of course also to other species. It's the mapping, and here again Eric Lander has showed us how it's done, of epigenetic effects, which meets with a lot of interest in society, because it is the idea of nature and nurture in a new way that is coming back. People's lifestyle, even the lifestyle of your grandmothers, influenced who you are and what you are doing. And so we see phenomenon like direct-to-consumer genetic testing that came from the US now also to Europe. People who are interested in tracing their ancestors. We see the meaning from context, as the results from the ENCODE projects are showing it, and we are seeing the replacement of a genetic determinism. So I come to the last part now. What does a social scientist do? This is a book I've written together with my co-author, Giuseppe Testa, who heads the lab of stem cell epigenetics in the European Institute of Oncology in Milano. And what we try to do in this book is to trace how the visibility that now has become possible, we can see in images, inside at the molecular level, at the genetic level, what we are made of. How this visibility has changed people's sense of identity and their relationship to others. And what we emphasize in this book very much is that there are both continuities and discontinuities. If you talk to people about the genetic revolution or the genomic revolution, very often it's the discontinuities that frighten people. On the other hand, there are many continuities. People have been dreaming, they have been told in fairy tales and in myths, for instance, with assisted reproductive technologies, what can be done. And we very much make the argument that especially human enhancement, for instance, in sports, makes the boundary between what is artificial, what is natural, disappear. Communication is a very important topic when we speak about science and society relations. And here we have moved, lessons have been learned, from what my colleagues call public understanding of science, that only if you inform the public better, the public will understand and will accept, to something which is called public engagement in science and with science, to listen also to the public, and not only to think that by information you can get engagement. Now, this involves also to bring social sciences on board. This is a map based on 7.2 million scholarly and scientific publications. And on the right side, the yellow part, are the social sciences. And the increase in relating to other parts has gone up in the last few years by 9%. But there is still a long way to go until the social sciences really link up wherever the sciences are coming up with new achievements. And this linking up also means that we have to take into account some of the results and useful findings from science and technology studies, like what does framing of a debate mean? We will have opportunity perhaps later on to go in greater details into that. What is a debate about? Is it about ethics? Is it about commercial interests? Is it about humanitarian, medical options, etc., etc.? And how this engagement can be better shaped is another point that I don't have the time to go into it now. So in the last part, I want to come back to something which is very much on people's mind. Where are the ethical reflections in society? The ethical reflections in society are indispensable, but they are not sufficient. And what I mean by that is something that ethics is not something that is imposed on science. Let me assure you, scientists, they all have their own ethical considerations. They are concerned about the ethical implications of their work. But ethical reflections and coming up with the results needs time. It cannot be taken off the shelf. Each case differs. You have also something called experimental ethics. And last but not least, we have to take the bigger picture into account as well. It's not only about moralistic stances, it's also about questions of inequality. And in a pluralistic society, there cannot be only one and the same answer. We have to debate, we have to negotiate, we have to reach some kind of consensus. So I come to my conclusions, how not to betray promises. I think this is something which is very strong if we want a better link between science and society, is to be careful with promises we make and not to betray them. Now, there are 5 points that I want to very briefly point out. It would be indeed a disaster if there were a pre genetic society in terms of its mindset, in terms of information and knowledge, meeting a post-genomic science. There have to be alternatives. And one of the alternatives is called citizen science, involving citizens in various ways early on, not only when a controversy erupts, but already when there is work in progress, work to be shared. It's not only the bright results, but it's also having the society and members of the public, allowing them, as Claude Bernard said in the 19th century, allowing them also into the kitchen and not only seating them in the salon. Education undoubtedly remains indispensable. Begin with personal genomics. Who am I? Something to be taught in schools. Something that goes across disciplinary boundary. One of the promises of epigenetics is precisely to bring in people's experience. This is of enormous importance. People's experience is part of the way how they shape their environment and how they are shaped by their environment. Creating spaces for letting this experience that people have being debated in public, sharing experience, making scientists listen to what this experience tells us instead of coming up with one solution that has to fit all. I'm most afraid of the corrosive effects of inequalities. We live in a society where everywhere, even in Sweden, I'm sure, inequalities have been going up for various reasons. And as we know, inequalities has several dimensions. And one possibility would be that we end up with a genetic divide, people who are very well informed and choosing partners who are from the same educational stratum, the same income level, will inevitably lead to a two-tier society that is divided. And last but not least, health is our most precious human resource. There are economists now working how they can replace the GDP indicator with something that is more meaningful, and they come up with the notion of wealth. And looking at the notion of wealth, it is very obvious that people's health is the most important factor that contributes to wealth. I end with a quote by Amartya Sen, a laureate in economics in the name of Alfred Nobel. Not that we should all be kept awake at night, but as a metaphorical question, what should keep us awake at night? Amartya Sen, who has not thought about the life sciences, I presume, but I think what his answer is valid for the life sciences as well. The tragedies that we can prevent, the injustice, including the injustice that nature treats us with when playing out its card, the injustice that we can repair. Thank you.
Thank you, Helga, for placing science's engagement with society so very centrally at the forefront of today's meeting, of our agenda for today's meeting. For our last talk of the morning, I'm very pleased to announce that we have Stephen Chu with us. Stephen Chu is one of the 1997 Nobel laureates in physics and also United States Secretary for Energy. Before taking up that post, he was head of the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory and held professorships at UCSF, both in physics and in molecular and cell biology. So, his talk, by the way, is entitled "The Role of Genomics in Energy and the Environment." Stephen Chu.
Thank you. Okay. Should go this way. Okay. Okay. And then I want to. Okay. Duplicate. Okay. Okay, very good. Thank you.
And then we switch.
Okay. All right, let's hope I have better luck than Eric. He said that his talk was somewhat untested, and I can assure you mine is untested. Anyway, I want to talk about the role of genomics in energy and the environment. Genomics is really beginning to play an increasingly important role, and it could really have a profound impact on things that we care about within energy, naturally associated very closely with climate, but also in food production and water. And these are challenges. This is, when you're in Washington for 4 years, you say the word challenge, but what you're really thinking is crisis. In any case, why a crisis? Well, we've been having some strange weather lately. But it doesn't mean lately in the last year, it means lately in the last 30 years and beyond. And this is some events that are tabulated by a reinsurance company that sometimes has to pay for these things. The maroon below is earthquakes. You see that it's very noisy, but hasn't been really affected. But then there are other things. Green are storms, heavy storms, or floods, or extreme temperatures, or droughts, and forest fires. And although it's very noisy data, you see something, it's increasing. And so it's not just 1 or 2 years, but over a period of 3 or more decades, it's increasing. And similarly, insurance losses are increasing. And so this is something we have to deal with. We pay for it now, we pay for it later, more money. But there's also extreme sociological disruption in all of these things. So the word crisis comes from an old Swedish verb, wage. and it's a compound word, and it's made up of two words, danger and opportunity. And so one of the things is you have to realize that in every crisis there are opportunities. So I'm going to talk about genetic modification, but I'm going to talk about genetic modification. I want to put it in the context. We've been modifying plants and animals for over 4,000 years. If you look at the example of early corn, you have these little things about the size of my pinky, and then you have more rapid development of corn being developed until you get these big, luscious corns that we now have. It's remarkable how this has been developed, but this domestic corn that you see on the left-hand side is a very modern corn that simply did not exist thousands of years ago. The yield of corn in the United States has been dramatic. This is a record from 1860 to 2011, and this is the yield of corn per acre. And so in the last 70 years, corn production per acre has increased sixfold. We also domesticated animals. This is pigs, our pigs. This is one of my favorite pigs, Wilbur, talking to the spider in the upper right-hand corner called Charlotte from E.B. White's novel, Charlotte's Web. Now, what would happen? And this is food for this afternoon. What would happen if you released these pigs and they just were gone wild, so to speak? Pigs gone wild, a new theme. Never mind. And what happens is in a half a dozen generations, you get things that look surprisingly like wild boar. So this is not your usual DNA evolution that's at work here, and we can discuss this in the afternoon. But these are feral pigs that are, either escaped or were released, and they look surprisingly not like Wilbur. Turkeys. Now, Europeans might not know about turkeys, but this is a big deal in the United States, especially around the end of November. These are domestic turkeys. Surprisingly, this is the domestic turkey that they turned into pets called Wally and Wendy. And these turkeys here are 6 months old. These turkeys, the same two turkeys, 10 months old, they're more or less the same size. These birds were bred to grow very, very rapidly. I don't know why they were bred to be white, but very, very rapid, and lots of breast meat. Now, how does that compare to wild turkeys? Well, I don't know what the age of these turkeys are, but they look very different. I do know what the age of these wild turkeys are. They're 8 years old. So, let me go on to more about agriculture. In 1968, Paul Ehrlich, Stanford biologist, wrote a best-selling book called The Population Bomb. And in this book, he said, the battle to feed all of humanity is over. In the 1970s and the 1980s, hundreds of millions of people will starve to death in spite of any crash programs embarked upon now. So, what happened? Well, this is world production of wheat from 1950 to 2004. And this is when the book came out. And in Mexico, India, Pakistan, something remarkable happened. Wheat production started to go dramatically. Also, grain production, like corn in the United States, was always growing in developed countries. But the most important thing was that in developing countries, it started to go and zoom up. What happened? It was breeding. And Norman Borlaug, who was awarded the Nobel Prize in Peace 2 years later, after the population bomb came out, had bred multiple strains of wheat into something that had huge grains, as you see from the left and right-hand side. The left-hand, and the picture on the right, the left-hand side has big grains. The wild one has lots of thistles and other things, but nothing you could eat. And so Borlaug bred strains of wheat with these overweight kernels, and they were so heavy that they would actually collapse, so he bred them so that the wheat stalks were shorter and sturdier, and they were called dwarf strains. And he also bred them so if you use artificial fertilizer instead of natural nutrients in the soil, you get this growth burst, but they would survive that. Now, it turned out that it was not all good things, and Borlaug was criticized because this type of work led to more fertilization and monocultures. And to that, Norman Borlaug answered his critics. He said they were the salt of the earth. They were very good people. But he also said, if they live just 1 month amid the misery of the developing world, as I have for 50 years, they'd be crying out for tractors and fertilizer and irrigation canals. So, now, this development of corn and wheat and the rice and everything else, again, led to this incredible production of grain. During that same time in the black is the amount of land put under grain production, while you see in red and blue the amount of food produced. And this it was at a time when you go from not from 1960 to 2005, the population more than doubled. It's remarkable. But then you might be thinking, well, this is just postponing the inevitable. What's the inevitable? Well, you've got the technological fix, and then 50 years or 100 years later, the population expands, and you've got another problem. You get another technological fix and another problem. We went through this in the beginning of the 20th century with fertilizer, now with breeding, but look what's happening. It's zooming up. We now have 7 billion people on our planet. We're going to add another billion in just 13 years. But ha-ha, if you look carefully at the right-hand part of this graph, a light may be at the end of the tunnel. The rate of fertility worldwide is going down, and it's projected that perhaps by the end of this century, 2100, the world population may peak at 10 billion, maybe 9.5 billion. We don't really know, of course, because as Eric said, predictions are hard to make, and Yogi Berra said, predictions are hard to make, especially about the future. Why is this going to happen? Well, it's a phenomenon we've seen in the developed countries, and it cuts across cultures, it cuts across religions, it cuts across everything. One common denominator: richer people have fewer kids. Now, I have my own theories. Of course, it's because women are more educated, and that really helps. But there's also other things, like the parents don't want to pay for their kids' college education and late night TV, but never mind. The fact is that in developed countries, among rich people, the fertility rate is actually negative. Okay, so we have to get over this hump. As the world grows in prosperity, we will get over the hump in the developing countries. So I am optimistic. All right, so let me talk about more innovative forms of genetic manipulations other than breeding. And this has to do with what Eric was talking about. It's the biochemical insertion of genes and promoters and synthetic biology. And so let me give you a few examples. Some companies, DuPont, Monsanto, are trying to develop food crops that are more resistant to drought. If it doesn't rain for a few weeks, the plants don't die. They just simmer and wait for rain. And you hear you have conventional corn crops, normal water in a drought. And in here you have it, they just hunker down and they wait for the water. They don't grow. That, you know, there's chemistry involved in that. You need the water for synthesis, but they don't die. And so this is something that's being developed. Also, if the soils are a bit starved, they don't die. They grow less, but they still grow with these altered genes. Now, you can do even better than that, and we are trying to do that. You have to look at certain plants. Many perennials, sugarcane is an example of a perennial. It grows year after year after year. Grasses are perennials. In the end of a growing season, all the nutrients go back into the soil. Many of these perennials also fix their own nitrogen. And so what we're doing, they don't really fix their own nitrogen. What they have in their roots are a symbiotic relationship with bacteria, and the bacteria with the roots create nitrogen fertilizer, essentially. And so what we're now trying to do is introduce into corn those type of gene-carrying things that we find in legumes and other nitrogen-fixing plants, so that you need less fertilizer. Fertilizer runoff, a big, big issue. Water polluting, terrible issue, and it's very energy-intensive. So that's another thing we're trying to do. Now let me describe the sort of plant microbe jungle warfare. Plants get attacked by all sorts of things. They get attacked by parasites like microbes, fungi, insects. And what a plant does is it tries to resist those attacks. And so there are only a few easy to digest parts. The easy to digest parts are the things that have to hold nutrients that an embryonic plant would like to eat without much trouble. And those are what's found. The embryonic plant is the seed, or the little kernel of the seed, and surrounding the seed, either the fruit or the nut, is the delicious food that bacteria love to eat, those starches and sugary stuff. But the plant sheaths that in this very protective layer. It's Christmas, so these are chestnuts. Or here's a corn plant. But most of the mass of the plant is designed to protect itself against the onslaught of these parasites like microbes. So as a result of that, if you look at the structure of most of the plant, most of the dry mass of the plant, here's a plant. In it you find these cells, and there's a very, very tough cell wall. If you blow up the inside of the cell wall, you have called microfibrils. But think of this as a steel cable. The steel cable is coated with a very complex molecule. The name's not important. It's called lignin, but it's just some big multi-ring molecule that is very, very protective and links together inside the contents of this material. The contents of this material, if you can find my here it is. The contents of this material are long, long chains of polymers, sugars. The individual sugars, let's say glucose, which is a six-carbon ring sugar, are these little symbols right here. This glucose is a crystalline, very tough crystalline stuff. Microbes and yeast and other things like to eat the simple sugars. But when compacted in this form, it's impervious. That's why we build houses out of wood. Wood lasts a long time. And so this is nature's way of protecting itself against this onslaught. Now, how do we break down this very complex woody material into simple sugars? This is actually, it's not a fully cartoon. This is a structural structure. It's an electron structure of an enzyme called a cellulase. This stuff down here are these long polymer chains, these steel cables that I was talking about. This is one cellulose long polymer chain. And what this thing is doing is it's creeping on there. It's pulling back one of those things. It goes into it, digests it, and clips off each glucose separately. It's a little machine that just strips it. What we do now is we're trying to develop very efficient enzymes to make this happen more quickly, less expensively. How do you do that? Well, you want to develop the enzymes. The normal way we want to develop new enzymes, new proteins, new medicines is the following. You start with a parent microbe, a parent, whatever, and you want to put into it the thing you want, and then you take this microbe and you mutate it. You mutate it chemically with radiation, and you just scramble the DNA. Most of the stuff in the mutations don't survive, but a few of them survive. And then what you do is you pick the best one, sort of the number one son, so to speak, and you take that, and this is the thing that survives in the environment you want, whatever you want it to do, and you mutate it again. And then you've got a lot of stuff, most of which don't survive, some of it does survive. You pick the best characteristics that you want, and then you mutate it again and again. So this is what evolution does over a thousands and millions of year period, but you can accelerate it by increasing the mutations, as I said, by X-rays or whatever. There's a better way of doing this. It's called shuffling. Instead of picking the very best, you actually look at all of these, the top three or four, and then you put those into the next genome, and you shuffle it using molecular biology techniques. And then so this is a set of daughters and sons, but with several parents, and then you see which ones survive and what characteristics you want. It's like breeding plants and animals, except it's not one plant versus another plant being bred together, or one cow and another cow. It's multiple cows and steer coming together. This you can do with microbes. You can't quite do it yet with cows. And there's even a better way of doing this that people have found, and that is don't pick the last top ones. Pick all of them and mutate it. Not completely all of them. You have a way of favoring it that you allow the computer program to find its maximum. But the trick here is that you have a wider set of sequences. And then the bad mutations you weed out later. Now, what is really going on here is explained very simply. Don't read the words, just look at this stuff about mutations. When you have a normal breeding cycle, you have a certain width, a spread. And what you do in this artificial mutation is you make the spread much wider. And so you get much more diversity per generation. And with that larger diversity per generation, you get to where you want to go much faster. And this is for these are rounds of generations. The wider spread allows you to identify the fringe that you really want in the end. So in the end, what you're looking for is you're trying to develop some fringe out of the tail of a distribution as quickly as possible. And it turns out you can go much faster this way. So that's another thing we're doing. This is a really interesting idea. It's kind of gruesome. It's being developed by a company called AgraVita. So you take a plant, and they pose the question, You know, the most expensive part of breaking down this woody material is the set of enzymes that you've had to develop over years and years and years. And so why not ask the plant to develop those enzymes that will digest itself? Now, that doesn't sound like a good idea, because if you put in genes that will digest itself, the plant doesn't have a good way of growing. It's digesting itself, right? So how do you get around this? So suppose there's an enzyme that you want, one of those cellulases that I showed you that structure of, that wants to break down the cell wall and take the complex sugars and turn it into simple sugars. You want the plant to grow the enzyme, so now it's really cheap. You don't have to grow them separately, separate them, and do all this other stuff. The plant itself is growing the good stuff. But how do you keep it from digesting itself? So there's a thing called an entine. It's an amino acid sequence. And you stick it in between the two parts of the amino acid sequence that make this enzyme. And this entine is just sitting there. And because it's sitting there, this protein doesn't fold into a functioning protein until you change its environment. And this company has chose very, very high heat, like 60 degrees centigrade, 70 degrees centigrade, 80 degrees centigrade, which until 100 years from today, the plant will never see. They're just going to see, you know, kind of room temperature for a while. And so, oops, what happened? Resume slideshow. Okay, I didn't give it enough care and love. And so what happens is when you expose it to heat, this sequence of amino acids brings itself together and splices itself out of the picture and couples the full protein, and which it then can fold. So before you expose it to some artificial condition, the protein doesn't fold, but it's accumulating in the organism, in the cells. You give it high heat, and then voila, it folds and digests. Kind of cool. And now they have to experiment. It's this little art, but as they get better and better, you know, if it's too much expression of this protein to digest itself, the plant doesn't do very well, seen as number 17 over here. But over here, you can get it to actually be almost as productive or equally as productive as a normal plant, but still digests itself. And so they're making good progress. All right, here's another cool idea, again, using genetics. Plants go through developmental cycles just as we do. We go from babies to teenagers to adults, back to teenagers. And plants also go through developmental cycles. But as they transition from a juvenile to an adult, they are actually making more protective mechanisms against the onslaught. And so it turns out that if you put in a gene called corngrass 1 gene, what happens is it retards the development of the plant, so it stays in the juvenile state. And when it stays in this juvenile state, it turns out that there's an increase of 2.5 times more starch in the plant walls. There's less of this lignin, which protects this stuff, so it's easier to break down. And here you have an energy crop called switchgrass with this corn gene, and this is the wild switchgrass. And it turns out it's looking like this is much easier to digest and break down with the introduction of this gene. This gene actually is something that doesn't introduce a new protein. It's actually more subtle than that. It introduces an RNA interference that actually, in the post-transcription, downregulates the development cycle. So again, something very neat. I'm going to skip trees. No, I'm not going to skip trees. Trees are kind of neat. So you can genetically engineer biomass, and you can ask, well, if you start with something like cellulose or carbohydrates, and you want to get it to gasoline or diesel, the carbon electron affinity is very, very different. If you start with coal or natural gas and want it to get to gasoline or diesel, you have a similar discrepancy in the carbon electron affinity. But it turns out that if you start with something with closer oxidation, carbon oxidation states, like terpene, as in turpentine, you're much better off. And so we are now genetically modifying pine trees that are actually used for lumber to increase the terpene content from 4 to 20% of the dry weight. Now these things begin to reek of this terpene stuff. This, you know, when you hug a pine tree, you get all the sticky stuff on you. That's part of it. And it reeks of it so much that you can now tap this terpene like maple syrup. So you get the benefit of a very inexpensive biomass growing. You suck out the terpene, and when it's really big, you can use the biomass also for lumber. This is actually commercially, lolly pine is commercially raised for paper, and so you can still use it for paper, or you can use it for biofuels as well. Another thing that Eric Lander mentioned very briefly is synthetic biology. Now, this is a plant grown in Southeast Asia. It turns out that an extract from this plant makes really great stuff for a new antimalarial drug, except it's very, very expensive. And so what Jay Keasley and others have done is they've taken an entire metabolic pathway. So this is lots of genes for proteins, lots of promoters, lots of stop-and-go signals, an entire metabolic pathway, dumped it into the poor bacteria or yeast, and asked this bacteria to spend most of its metabolic energy making a medicine. This has worked. It's being commercially available. It's reducing the antimalarial drug cost fourfold. But the question is, can you actually do this and turn genetic synthetic organisms, entire metabolic pathways, into yeast or E. coli bacteria to produce ethanol or heavier alcohols like butanol or even drop-in substitutes? And the answer is yes, you can. It's been done. You can now feed simple sugars into these microbes, and out pops a precursor for gasoline or diesel. It's being tested commercially in pilot plants in Brazil, and the ultimate goal is that it feeds directly on the very complex cellulosic material to convert it. So again, we're making progress. The core of it is genetic modification. I want to spend some time talking about biofilms. This is my last postdoc. I had a big group when I became Secretary of Energy, and it's whittling down. And this is Fussell Burke, and it's work he's been doing over the last 5 years on biofilms. So what's a biofilm? If you take bacteria, they're floating around and free, but they land on a surface, and they begin to colonize. And this is the sideways look at what these things are doing. And they begin to form a community of bacteria, and a protective community of bacteria. Why do they want to do this? Well, bacteria invade a host organism, like people, there are all sorts of things. The host organism generates antibodies that attack the individual microbes. There are phagocytes. That's a form of a white blood cell. Discovery got a Nobel Prize long ago in medicine or physiology. This is a phagocyte. This is anthrax bacilli. And this phagocyte is actually eating them up. And once it's engulfed, it digests it and spits out the remains. And so these bacteria don't want to be food lunch for a phagocyte, or they don't want to be killed by antibodies. So they develop these films. These biofilms are everywhere. They start in the bottoms of boats. This is the bottom of a boat, and you get this scum that starts in the bottom of the boat. It's really tough stuff. You have to take the ship, put it in dry dock, and scrape it off manually. It can degrade the fuel efficiency of a boat by 20%, and many billions of dollars in just the United States alone are spent taking ships out of dry docks, scraping off the bottoms, and to counteract this biofouling. So if you can figure out how to do something about this, that's a good thing. And finally, let me talk about energy production in biofilms. Now, this, to a homeowner, is a very queasy feeling. These are wood termites, and you don't want wood termites in your home, but you can look upon them as little machines that convert this woody material into biofuel that itself uses. Now, if you ask how does it do that, it's got these mandible jaws that shred up the wood, but it doesn't itself digest the wood. In the gut of a termite, and this is the gut of a termite down here, there are these little nodules full of communities, and those communities are actually bacteria, multiple types of bacteria that form a biofilm. And it's that biofilm that actually finally digests the wood. The same sort of bacterial colonies are found in the guts of cows and sheep and everything that also eat woody grass. And so they convert this very hard woody material into food. If you and I ate wood, it would not be very nutritious. But these animals and these critters have found a way to do that. So, how do we want to approach studying these biofilms? So we were stimulated by the great American philosopher of the 20th century. In case you're wondering who that is, that's Yogi Berra. He's a catcher for the New York Yankees, a retired catcher. And here's Yogi having a philosophical conversation with an umpire. He said many important things, you know, like predictions are hard to make, especially about the future. If you come to a fork in the road, take it. He also said you can observe a lot by just watching. That's what we want to do here. All right, so here's a cell we want to study, or a community of cells. And what we do is Here's an antibody that will recognize a specific protein or polymer structure or whatever. And then to that, we add a fluorescent molecule. Now, normally, if this is in solution, these fluorescent molecules and this protein are moving around with Brownian motion, kind of like that. And when they spatially go around, zooming around so quickly, and you're taking a picture of that, it all gets blurred out. So instead of a single dot of fluorescence, you see this very dim blur. And you've got a lot of these things blurred together. You have a steady background. However, what if one of these babies lands on the target? It's now stationary. The Brownian motion stops, and then you see a dot of light. Now, the question is, what do you want to do with that dot of light? Well, in a normal optical microscope, that dot of light is a blur defined by physics. And the physics tells you that the best you can do is resolve this blur, this width blob, to about 215 nanometers. All right. So if you've got a lot of these dots of light, like this, then you just this big blobby thing, and what you're limited to is this optical resolution. But suppose you ask another question. You ask for the single dot of light, not blurred with other dots of light. Where's the center of that? This one. That one alone, with none of the others there. You can find the center of that to this blur circle divided by the signal to noise. Okay, if the signal to noise is 10 to 1, it's 25 nanometers. If it's 100 to 1, it's 2.5 nanometers. It's a fundamental statistical thing. All right? So this random excitation, so you got one dot of light and it disappears, another dot of light and it disappears, another dot of light disappears. We have been developed over the last 6 years. Three significant names, Eric Betzig, Harold Hess, formerly of Bell Labs, now at Genelia Farms, Howard Hughes, and Xiaowei Zong at Harvard, developed these techniques. Now we're going to use this, and remember, this is now giving an effective resolution of 10 to 20 nanometers. I should say as an aside, if you do a lot of other things, you can actually get much better than that. You can get to about 0.5 nanometers, but that's another story. All right, so here's a biofilm. This is, the first is a conventional, okay, here it is, and let me go. And this is a movie of the biofilm. So it starts with conventional microscopy, and this is the bacteria landing on a surface and beginning to grow. And so you see these biofilms evolving and growing. And now you're scanning upwards on this, it's a confocal microscope, so you're scanning upwards and you can get a three-dimensional picture of this. All right? Now this is a biofilm and you see it a three-dimensional construction, so you're taking slices, and so as this biofilm grows, you can see this. Since it's a confocal microscope, you're doing a little bit better, but here you see the thing growing, and All right. So now here's the complete biofilm. We put fluorescence markers on several components, several critical proteins, as well as the bacteria cells themselves. So as an example of this biofilm, you see, it'll go into this. This is a cell cluster. The shell protein is in red. The blue guys are the cells. The cement proteins are in gray, and so on and so forth. And we've looked at three or four proteins and some polysaccharides and polymers that glue this thing together. The point here, which is different, is this is a motion picture of a live growing biofilm for the first time. Okay? So let me stop the movie. And what do we see? Well, when we were looking at the data, my postdoc was telling me, well, you know, there's a strange thing. If you look at these clusters, they have the thin dimension seems to be very uniform. The thick dimension varies all over the lot. And I said, And if you look at it more closely, what are you seeing? You're seeing gaps and holes. The biofilms, the bacteria need nutrients, and they've got to get rid of the waste. There's no circulatory system. So they have channels that allow the stuff to flow. And so one of our next experiments, we think these are channels, and so one of our next experiments is actually to see how they flow. If they're really flowing, we can actually introduce molecules, flash them light, cross-link them, plug up the channels, and in so doing, kill the biofilm. Antibiotics do not kill biofilms. Phages don't kill biofilms. And so this is another way of killing them, starve them to death and constipate them to death. So, all right, now let me go to the high-resolution stuff. In a conventional microscope, 200 nanometers, you see a blur circle like this. This is what we see with the very high resolution. Okay? Now let me blow up that picture. That's what we see. We see it in three dimensions. So what we have is essentially molecular resolution in three dimensions with live stuff growing. Totally cool. It's one of the sad things about being Secretary of Energy is you have to not spend full time doing this. One other little thing. I'm Secretary of Energy for a very good reason. and I love doing it because I think it's important. But you know, a few hours a week I can get to this other stuff. So another thing I want to tell you, and this has to do with cancer. This is my second to last postdoc, who's now an assistant professor, Shaolin Nan. And this is has to do with how cells get talk to each other. This is the surface of the cell. This is the outside of the cell. This is a schematic of a cell membrane. This is a receptor, a signaling receptor, just like this year's Chemistry Nobel Prize, the structure of the G protein receptor. There are a lot of receptors on the cells. And so you have signaling molecules. They land on the receptors. And what that does is it starts to stimulate a chain reaction of chemical events that then go into pathways. And in this particular pathway we're looking at, these names, don't worry about them. These pathways start to govern the growth of a cell, instructions of whether a cell should divide or not, whether it should move or not, all these things. And the thing about cells is they're embedded in tissue, and they just don't grow like crazy. They don't grow as means they grow, they divide, they grow, they divide, and all this other stuff. Because outside signals say, don't do that. That's antisocial behavior. But if they lose the ability to be regulated from the outside due to mutations of these signaling proteins, and these in red called RAS and RAF, they actually, with mutated molecules, they can promote growth and division without outside signals. And this is why these mutations are associated with these particular molecules, mutations are associated with about a third of all human cancers. Cancer is uncontrolled cell division and growth. All right, so there's a miracle drug that's just been recently released, and it was determined and hypothesized that these mutant molecules will come together and form what's called a dimer, just indicated schematically here. And this company, Plexion, has developed a drug indicated by these little stars. And without this drug, these things come together, mutant forms come together without an outside signal, and they induce cell growth and division. And so what this company has done is, this is the drug. The star is just a symbol for a mutation. This is a small molecule that lands on this mutant drug. Only the mutant, a small molecule lands on only the mutant molecule, not the healthy molecule. So there's very little side effects, and it keeps them from becoming dimers. And this is a new drug, and it promotes cell death, tumor shrinkage, a very dramatic, quote, cure for a large fraction of the patients. So what are we going to do? You test the hypothesis. How many other types of molecules, when they mutate, come together, form this dimer, and allow downstream signaling when it shouldn't ought to be because it's no longer stimulated from the outside? The way you do this before was you take an electron signal. This is an antibody, and the antibody is now attached to a little gold particle, and this is a picture of all these antibodies and gold particles. And what they found is that, yes, they're forming dimers and clusters, but the only trouble is, in order to see a signal, you have to overexpress this mutant form so much that it could be an experimental artifact. They're forming clusters, but there's too many of them, all right? So it's the lack of sensitivity of electron microscopy immunotechniques. What we do is we use our single molecule fluorescence, and we look at a normal cell, and we find, oh, just look at the picture, it's Yogi Berra. Are they forming dimers? You can see by eye they're not. Down here, in the mutant form, you see a lot of dumbbells with your eye. Voila. But you notice this, well, you may not notice, but this is two orders of magnitude better sensitivity, up to three orders of magnitude higher sensitivity. And so what we find is they're forming these dimers. We then use a standard biological trick, and we can turn up the mutant form and adjust it. And what we find is many orders of magnitude lower than what could you see in an electron microscope, they form the dimers, and they do downstream signaling. Many orders of magnitude below the concentration you need to see with an electron microscope. So, and these are blue curves. When you see a bump, it's forming dimers. I'm not going to explain what this stuff means, except you can see with your eye they're lumpy. And a very, very low concentration. This is an antibiotic that allows you to adjust the expression of the mutant form of the protein. So that's another extremely good thing. So let me end by just quoting what Leonardo da Vinci said. He said, knowing is not enough, we must apply. Being willing is not enough, we must do. And so genomics has an opportunity to help us on a path to a sustainable world. It's not only through discovery, but it's through invention. And then innovation means you get it out in practice. And what is this all for? Well, to confer the greatest benefit on mankind. Thank you.
Secretary Chu, thank you very much indeed for highlighting so many possible applications of genomics and for seeding so many of the discussions in this afternoon's session. Now, if you'll just bear with me for just a couple of minutes, it would be, I think, useful to run through what's going to happen now, because that was the sort of simple part of the program where we sit and listen to lectures, interviews. After this, you have to get a bit more proactive and choose what you want to do. So, over lunch, we intend to feed both the body and the mind, and we've organized six different activities that you can partake of while having a sandwich wrap, and you'll find sandwiches outside. You've got this on your program too, but I'd just like to point out that we expanded the space available a little bit just yesterday, and so we have a little bit more room, and the room changes are marked in red there. But of course, the sign, there'll be very good signposting, so you'll find where you want to go. And let me just run through these activities very quickly. There are in the general foyer, which is just outside, there's going to be a discussion panel on communication in science, and you can eat and listen to that. Or you can go and watch the video screening of the interview with Jim Watson and Francis Crick, and that's going to be held in two different rooms, and all those things are through the doors and out there. Then there's going to be another discussion panel, this one held in Swedish. Everything else will be in English. And this is on the research environment for genetics and genomics in Sweden. And then there are going to be three so-called introductions to the afternoon discussion streams. And in those, a couple of the participants on the panels in that stream are going to give short 15-minute talks introducing just some of the concepts that, and ideas that might come up in the discussions. Now, those are being held in the rooms you see there. And all of these events are going to be standing events. So there aren't chairs there. We expect people to wander about, wander into discussions, listen to them, and if they like, wander out and listen to another one while eating or drinking. Except for the last one, which is being held in Nora Latin, the introduction to Stream 3. That's being held across the street. So to get there, you have to brave a little bit of cold just across to Nora Latin. But the reward for doing that is that there are seats there. There are also sandwiches and drinks and coffee being served there. So if you want to go to that one and have a seat, then please do, but you don't need to take anything from this building. Just grab your sandwiches when you get there. And I don't think you need coats. You just cross the street. So that's lunch. And we're running a bit late, so I think what we should... But don't go yet, because there's more to say. I'm sorry. It gets yet more complicated. We'll start, I think, 15 minutes late, so just add 15 minutes to the timing, so these panels won't start until 12:30 rather than 12:15. If I could have the next slide. After lunch, which will now be at 1:30, not 1:15, we'd like you to come back to this room, but by then this room will have been transformed into three rooms, and you can choose. You can listen either to the discussions in Stream 1, or the discussions in Stream 2, or the discussions in Stream 3. There are two panels in each, but we'd prefer that the audiences sort of stay put for the two panels, because we're just going to run the two panels sequentially. So there's going to be one, and then there's going to be an immediate change into the second panel. So broadly, Stream 1 is about about medicine. Stream 2, as you've seen, is about genetics in agriculture and the environment, and then a second panel on nature-nurture, genetic determinism. And then Stream 3 is going to be having one panel on human evolution and synthetic biology and one panel on new biology and broadly on the regulation of gene expression. So, having done that, we're going to then reward you for having concentrated so hard with, next slide please, a glass of wine. While you have the glass of wine, the technicians will work to turn this room back into one room. And then we'd like to invite you all back in here for a concluding panel. And that's pretty simple, because that will just be a panel discussion. So I think that sums everything up. I wish you an enjoyable and intellectually stimulating lunch, and look forward to seeing you back here at 1:30.